Thanks, Ivan. During his two terms in presidency, President Obama's look has changed dramatically. But do you know that his voice has changed too? That's what voice biometrics will reveal in this study. So, you know, when it takes up to 100 muscles for someone to speak, for someone to say hello. So hello, everyone. In fact, muscles of the larynx, the vocal tract, and lungs play an important role in shaping our voice. Add to this the effect of the vocal cords and both the nervous and hearing system. So you can imagine that any change in these will affect in a way or the other the way we speak. Just a disclaimer here. Actually, this study focused only on people of age 18 and above. We're not considering the case where there is a change in voice between childhood and adulthood, which we know is actually very, very, very pronounced. So, and like any muscle, the muscles of the vocal system are affected by aging. Our respiratory system will become less efficient, which makes us speaking slower. The cartilage of the larynx will become less flexible, which make changes to the pitch and forms. There is an increasing risk of hearing loss, which which makes us speaking actually louder. Add to this the shakiness in our voice due to the change in nervous system. So you can actually reduce the effect of voice aging by being physically and socially active, but there is no doubt that age will appear at some point in our life. Some people actually nowadays do medical surgery to repair their vocal cords. Some others actually do what we call voice lifting, which actually they inject collagen in their cords to plump up their cords. So, and this is very common among celebrities. So actually, some celebrities during their career, they do different kind of lifting, starting from weightlifting to, and then they end up by doing facelifting and even now voice lifting. So this is just to say that actually Hollywood celebrities are not good examples on which we should do our research study, especially when we talk about aging, face aging or even voice aging. In this rare study conducted on 50 years worth of data from a normal male speaker from age 48 till age 98, researchers found that the fundamental frequency will decrease in the first 20 years, and then it will increase in the next 30 years. They also found that the words per breath will actually decrease almost linearly over time. I would like to thank actually Eric Hunter for giving us permission to use this figures. So in these first slides, we introduce the phenomenon of voice aging. Let's see how this affects voice biometrics. So what are biometrics? Many of you maybe knows about biometrics, but I will go, I will explain it a bit, and then I will explain if automatic speaker recognition can be considered as a form of biometric. And also we try to answer the questions, are automatic speaker recognition affected by voice aging? What are the security risks and what are the usability risks? Is short-term voice aging a real concern? And what are the possible solutions to prevent that problem? So let's start by voice biometrics. And first, this is how biometrics is defined by ISO. So biometrics is the automated recognition of individuals based on their behavioral and biological characteristics. Examples of biometrics are DNA matching, iris, face recognition, and also speaker recognition is added to the list. However, Anil Jain, a well-known researcher in biometrics, mentioned in his paper in 2015 that the two fundamental tenets of biometrics are distinctiveness, uniqueness, and persistence. And he also wrote, without analyzing the distinctiveness and persistence of a biometric trait for the population of interest at sufficient scale, it's unreasonable to make strong claims about the recognition accuracy and utility of the trait in large-scale applications. Any such claim must be tempered by clearly stating the caveat and scope of the reported results. So the question that might pop up here, are voice prints persistent? Don't they change with age? And if it's the case, we need to highlight this and make it clear to the community, especially the people that are using this technology. So let me start first by introducing how a speaker recognition system works. So first, for example, when you call your bank, the call is either recorded or processed on the fly. And then there are a bunch of steps that are applied, starting from speech activity detection to discard the noise and the musing and any non-speech part. And then the next step is capture analysis, where we extract features like frequency capsule coefficients or PLP. And then the next step is we apply our machine learning algorithms like Gaussian mixture model or lately deep neural networks. And then we extract the so-called voice prints. So this is the first step. That's where we have voice prints. What to do with these voice prints? So if it's your first time you're calling your bank, for instance, what we will do is that we will enroll your voice. We'll create a speaker model, what we call a speaker model. And if it's not the first time you're calling your bank, so what we'll do is that we will compare your current voice print with the model that we already enrolled. And then if the likelihood score is higher than a tuned threshold, we say this is actually the right, the correct speaker, the genuine speaker, the genuine caller, and we give him access to his account, and he can do he can change his address and all this information, and if not, we say no, this is actually an imposter or a fraudster, and then there will be usually a fraud analyst that will work on it. So basically, the likelihood score is not a value. It's not a single value. It follows two Gaussian distribution. One for the genuine scores, the one on the right, and the one for the imposter scores. And the overlap region actually is the region which determines the error. So our goal as researcher is to reduce that overlap region. Okay. And then the threshold, the choice of the threshold depends on the application. So if we want, if our bank wanted a high level of security, so what they will do is that they will shift the threshold to the right. Okay, but so we will reject imposter, but there is most likely we will reject more genuine speakers. So this is we should make sure not to rejecting that much genuine speaker as well. And basically, by playing with this threshold, we can compute false acceptance rate and false rejection rate. And we can draw this nice dead curve. For example, in this dead curve, we compare four different systems. The one in red is actually the worst system, and the one in blue is the best system. And this best system is actually is the closest to the origin. Okay. And the researchers and even vendor report usually the equal error rate about their system. For example, in this case, the equal error rate is actually equal to 7.6%. So equal error rate is actually the threshold where the value on which for which false acceptance rate is equal false rejection rate. So now that we introduced voice biometrics, we introduced the aging, let's see how voice aging affects voice biometric system. So the aging factor comes into play when we start considering the effect of delta T, which is the difference between enrollment and test time. But why this factor is actually important? Who has called his bank in the last 8 months? Can you So maybe only 20% or as much. So we found in a study that among these 20%, we found that only 48% of callers call their bank only once, and 22% call twice. And usually, actually, only 25 to 50% of these calls exit to the agent. So the rest are actually serviced by the IVR itself. So actually, in this study, we found that the majority of customers don't call their bank that often. This makes aging an important factor to consider while deploying a voice biometric system in real life. So this is our first study that we did on President Obama's voice. So what we did is that we took all his weekly addresses during his 2 terms in office, and it's actually over 400 recordings. We removed some of the recordings where, for example, First Lady appeared or Vice President Joe Biden appeared. And then also we removed some of the recordings where we found that the background noise is very high, to remove this also from the equation. And let's see how that audio looked like.
We begin this year and this administration in the midst of an unprecedented crisis that calls for unprecedented action.
So this is his first weekly address back in January 2009. Let's see, in 2011.
Last month, our economy added more than 100,000 private sector jobs.
In 2013.
Hi, everybody. This week, I announced a series of concrete steps we should take.
And in 2015.
Hi, everybody. Every day, we get thousands of letters and emails to the White House from Americans across the country.
So as you might see, the quality of the recording is actually quite good. But however, it's actually different for us to perceive the difference in voice, right? In the change in voice. However, voice biometric system are actually very sensitive to this. And so what we did is that we enrolled President Obama's voice using his first weekly address, and then we compared all upcoming test data with this recording, with this model. And this is actually the curve that we can draw. So as we see that the likelihood score will decrease from 11% from 11 to almost 8.5 in this 8 years. And what's interesting is that actually, for example, if the bank is setting the threshold at 10, let's say, which is high level of security, which this means that actually the system will start rejecting President Obama after only 2 years. Okay, so this is really a concern for us as voice biometric researchers, and we need to solve this problem. So, I did a spectral analysis to figure out what's happening, actually. So what I did is that I computed the fundamental frequency over time. And you see it's dropping by almost 5% in this 8 years. So there is something happening, actually, in the spectral domain that our voice biometric is not accounting for it. And then we did actually the same study on President Bush. Again, we see that the likelihood score decreased from 10 to 7.5 in only 4 years. So you may ask why 4 years? Because the quality of the recording before 2004 were very bad. So that's why we wanted to focus on only age factor and not other factors. And this is actually a real problem. When we deal with this kind of research, we have to rule out or reduce the effect of other factors such as microphone, compression and coding techniques, and also we have to remove the effect of background noise. So And also, we have to control the intra-class intra-speaker variability, or we call it intra-class variability, such as emotion and health of the speaker. So we have to reduce the effect of this. Another main challenge, really this is very important, is the difficulty to continuously collect data from the same subject for a long period of time. And this is really this is really a problem that us researchers are facing nowadays. Anyway, we were able actually to collect, I would say, a large data set compared to previous studies, with 122 speakers with clean recordings. The majority of these speakers are actually English speaking, but also there are French, Italian, German, and Spanish and Dutch speakers. So the time span is 2 years, and here we report the progress of the equal error rate over time. So in 2 years span, the equal error rate doubled from 4% to 8%. So this is really a problem. And what's interesting is that in only 4 months, which is correspond to 17 weeks, the equal error rate dropped from 4% to almost 5%, a bit less than 5%. So we start seeing degradation in only 4 months. So let's see what's happening actually in the score. So remember that score distribution of imposter scores and genuine scores, at, let's say at time T0. So what's happening is that at time T1, let's say in 4 months, the genuine scores distribution will shift to the left, okay, which makes the overlap region bigger. And this is actually the cause of the errors. And at time T2, that overlap region will continue increasing. Okay. So that's why we need to solve the problem. And some people actually started doing this. But here, keep in mind that actually any compensation won't be perfect. For example, in the decrease of likelihood score for if we consider the decrease of likelihood score to be linear for the two presidents, it's not following the same decrease. The angle is not the same. So this means that every speaker aged differently, and it's really not easy to account for this problem. Okay. So, but still, there are some characteristics that are shared across speakers, and the practical proof is that automatic age estimation is actually possible. And there is a study from last year was done, and they showed that they can compute the age with an error of only 4.7 years. Let's see if we can actually do better. So I'll do a small quiz here.
Can you guess my age from the sound of my voice? Am I in my 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, or 70s?
Who said 30s? Who said 40s? Who said 50s? Okay, so the majority actually said 40s, and this is actually the case. The speaker has an age of 43. So this means that actually there are some characteristics that are shared across speaker, and we should be able to compensate to the age factor using this information. So there is a study done in 2013 where people were able to control the error. So for example, if you want to control the equal error rate, what they were doing is that they were moving the threshold. They were making the threshold interval dependent. So for example, if this is the threshold at time T0, this is how it looks at time T1. Okay, so the threshold is moving depending on the time interval between enrollment and test. And this is, for example, at time T2. But this is not actually a great solution, because as you might see, the equal error rate is still increasing in this case. The errors are still increasing. So the same guys actually did a study in 2016 where they where actually they did a score calibration technique where they used that information, they used that time difference between enrollment and test data to calibrate the scores, to tune the scores, to shift that those distributions to where they should go. So for example, at time T1, that's the correction that will be done, okay? And at time T2, this is the correction. So actually, here the overlap region is decreasing, right? So this is a good solution, but still it's not complete solution. And we actually tried to figure out why, and we found that they were not taking into account the actual age of the speaker. For example, if you enroll at age 20 and you test at age 25, it's not the same as enrolling at age 80 and testing at age 85. Okay, so we need to take the actual age also into account. We also found that actually the gender also influence the age. Ladies don't age similarly to men. So this also factor should be taken into account. So that's why actually we introduced these two factors also together with the time intervals into the score calibration. And here the correction will be much better. So the three distribution of the general scores at time T0, T1, T2 will look almost the same. There is still an error, and this we cannot account for this because it's speaker dependent. So that's why we need to propose. It's not. So yeah, that's why we need to update the model more frequently. And this is possible. So whenever a new test sample is available, what we'll do is that we will verify this is the right speaker, and then we will use this sample to update the model. Okay. So this what will happen if we update the model, for example, for Obama's voice. So you remember the baseline was actually the blue line, right? So when we update frequently this model, we will have this red line, which is a flat line, right? So this is pretty cool. But the problem here is that we won't have these test sample as frequent as we have them for President Obama. You remember I was mentioning we call rarely in a interval of 8 months. Another problem which is very important in this kind of scenario is that if for example a fraudster was able to attack the system few times, let's say, so what's gonna happen is that his model will get enrolled, and in this case voice biometrics will be not effective at all. So this is the risk of identity theft that may happen in this case. So that's why we propose to, before any update of the model, we propose to add some constraint, add some quality assessment, do some quality assessment. So we need to make sure that we're sending the a secured sample before updating the model. And this can be done in a multi-factor manner, authentication manner. So that's the action that we would like to you to take. So make sure to put in place spoofing countermeasure to detect, for example, impersonation, to detect audio playback. It's easy to find a YouTube video or recording of you. So make sure to put this kind of spoofing countermeasure in your system. The other kind of countermeasures are like the pitch change and voice conversion. It's now easy for me to use an app to change my voice to look like someone that has age 70. So we need actually to put this kind of countermeasures in place. More recently, there is also a new spoofing that was introduced, which is actually the speech synthesis. So, for example, now Adobe Voco. With Adobe Voco, you can write something and sound like President Trump. Okay. So, So make sure to put in place a good countermeasure, a good spoofing detection system. Also, before any update, make sure to make sure that the quality of the recording is good. Look at, for example, the signal to noise ratio. Look, for example, at the amount of net speech. If, for example, you have if you have only 1 second of net speech in your test data, you maybe don't want to update the model. Okay, so we would suggest here to have at least 20 seconds of net speech before updating that model. Also, try to use any externally provided assessment like phone printing or one-time password. So it's time to wrap up this presentation. So voice aging appears mainly in pitch and speech changes. Voice aging is a real concern for voice biometric system. We saw that the equal error rate actually could double in only 2 years. There is a potential to reduce its effect by applying score calibration and model update, but make sure to employ spoofing detection, voice-based quality assessment, and other available in-house assessment. Thank you for your time. This is the reference that we use in the study. And these are the people that I would like to thank. I would like to thank the research team and the marketing team and also all Pindroppers that contribute to the study. Thank you. Any question? Yeah. Very, very good question. Actually, they age less. From the if we look at the pitch, the pitch will actually decrease over time, but the change is not as pronounced as for male speakers. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
Yeah. Can we use voice for authentication?
This is actually, that's what voice biometrics is actually about. It's for voice biometrics is used for authentication purposes, yeah.
So how easy it is? Like, for example, we use Amazon Echo every day.
Yep.
And it can we enable voice authentication integrated with all the devices?
That's very, very good question. And so there are a lot of research studies nowadays that are trying to solve that problem, to include, together with the voice recognition, include also voice recognition in this case means speech recognition, so speech to text, right? So introduce together, add to this actually the speaker recognition system, so to make that system more secure, and avoid any problems. For example, if my daughter want to access the system, to have more control on this and to have better use of. So there are studies nowadays that are trying to solve this problem, and we're also working on this. Any question? Okay, so thanks everyone. Thanks for coming. It's the last day, I know.